Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Killer Bunny by Timothy Ellis, narrated by Amy Gorelow. 1. Black sheep, listen up. The two thick rings with the thin ring in between were heavy on my sleeves. Space Marshal Wolfenstein had promoted me only an hour ago, and it hadn't really sunk in until this moment. I'd wanted this. I'd worked for it. Now it was time to prove I was worth it. The problem was, my mind was still stuck on my call sign and just how seriously anyone took it. They'd given me the second word as a joke. Then, Rear Admiral Jane had added to it with the first word after I hit the top of the kill board on our first mission. And even though I hated it, no one would change it. Concentrate. 11 pilots were sitting in front of me in the squadron briefing room, and I was standing at the podium. From the smirks on a few faces, I could see they couldn't see past my call sign either. Although, to be honest, the smirks could have just been because I was only standard 18 and was a girl, and they were guys less than 2 years older than I was. "For those who don't know me," I started. The squadron had been reformed after a long period of flying in a special wing, and I knew none of them. It was possible a few of them knew of me. The League had lots of pilots now, not enough to fill an Intrepid class carrier yet, but it wouldn't be long. My name is Squadron Leader Liza Pound. My call sign is Killer Bunny, and if any of you ever use it, I will shoot you myself. Are we clear? There were a few hastily stifled chuckles, probably because of how my face looked. The rest just looked confused.
"What do we call you in space, ma'am?"
asked one of my two flight lieutenants, Jason Mendelson. "Skipper will work. Black Sheep Lead will also work. Lead if you're in a hurry. Ma'am is something I don't like either, but it will work when out of the cockpit if said with the right tone in the right moment. But no one uses my call sign for any purpose at any time. If anyone does, you'll feel my boot. And if you don't think my boot is worthy of being afraid of, then pay attention to the first part of my call sign." They all knew what it was now without me telling them again, but very few people believed it until they saw me in combat. "Call me Skipper or something like that, and we'll get along nicely." Mendelson nodded, and so did the other flight lieutenant, Nikki Twining. "We've all come from the special wing that Space Marshal Wolfenstein has been running, and we're used to flights of 8. That changes now, back to the normal flights of 4. Flight Lieutenant Twining has B flight, and Flight Lieutenant Mendelson has C. I'll be leading A flight, obviously. We're going into the simulators immediately, and for the first hour, you'll work as a flight. The following hour will be as a squadron. We'll talk about it before we go to lunch, and after, we'll be in battle." That made most of them nod. There were no rookies here. All of us had battle experience, but I needed now to work out who had what skills, and I'd only had a couple of minutes with each of their records so far. What I'd needed wasn't in what I'd already read. "I don't care where you came from. I don't care what your kill score was in your last unit. We're starting fresh. We'll run together in the morning. We'll be doing marine training straight after, and we'll always eat together from now on." More nods. They expected that. "There will be none of that naked hot tub nonsense in my squadron. What you do in your off time is your own business. But if anyone starts fixating on what someone's body looks like naked, they better like a boot up their arse." Smiles now. Rock Monster had started bucking the trend of how midshipman squadrons were formed into a unit. A lot of us had followed that. It had caused some issues, but those were all dealt with at the squadron level by whoever was supervising each midshipman class. The Imperium military had been good like that. Now the League of Worlds military was. There were classes who still soaked naked together, but it was more optional now. "The Black Sheep has a history. If you don't know it already, look it up. We will not be following the original squadron's way of doing things, but we don't need to since the League provides everything we need when we need it, and they didn't have that. But we will be following their example in space. They were one of the highest scoring squadrons for their nation in their war, and I expect us to keep that tradition going." Several had the look of scanning invisible screens, but the rest looked enthused. Or at least, I thought they did. "Right. Mendelson and Twining remain. The rest of you get to your simulator and check your co-pilot has the bird configured properly for you. Get your eye in if you want to. Dismissed? They all rose as one, braced, and then relaxed and shuffled out. The two flight leaders stayed standing where they were. I waited for the door to close behind the last pilot. I'm Liza in private.
Jason.
Nikki. They knew who was senior then. Not by a lot, though. Your flights are yours to run as you want to. All I want from you is the best performance you can get out of your pilots. And I don't care how you do that, short of breaking rules. We're gonna live or die by our strafing ability, at the flight and squadron levels. One of the things I'm gonna be looking for is who in the squadron has the best grasp of strafing command, so I want you to test your pilots and let me know who's best.
Why?
Asked Nikki. How much do you know about Space Marshal Wolfenstein?
Nothing. Should I?
It's always a good idea to study your superiors. He's what I'm looking for. He wasn't an official flight leader in Navy Mage One, and yet he led the squadron.
Why?
Partly because of the nature of that squadron and the CO, our Knight Marshal, doing mage stuff instead of leading, but mostly because he's the expert on squadron strafing. Have you ever seen Navy Mage One in action?
No, said Nikki.
Nope,
said Jason. Look them up. A lot of their missions are a matter of record. I want us functioning at that level, and their performance wasn't all about magic either.
What do you know about Rock Monster?
Asked Jason. Essentially our CAG, or Commander Air Group. The term was traditional. She flew with Hammer and Dreamwalker back when the strafe was still a new thing. You should study her record as well.
I take it you have? Asked Nikki.
Damn right I have. If you want squadrons of your own one day, I suggest you do as well.
So we're better suck-ups? Asked Jason.
Nikki lost it, although I hadn't thought it was that funny. And I started warming to the girl as a result. Only if you want a job piloting a garbage scow. He grinned, and I had a look at what his sense of humor was like. I was pretty sure he knew there was no such thing, but it didn't stop anyone using it as a threat. That was traditional, too. Okay, I went on. Let's get in there. We've only got a couple of hours to make this squadron operational. I want those recommendations at lunchtime, but only when we're alone. Let's go. I headed for the door without waiting for an answer.
2.
Talk to me, Zack. Zack was my AI co-pilot. He'd chosen his own name and didn't use any form of surname. He was just Zack. We'd been together since day one of my midshipman training. He was now a flight officer, having been promoted with me.
12 birds on the ready line, Skipper. Hercule is getting ready to jump, but we're fourth in the order of launch to deal with fleet caps.
Hercule was an intrepid class carrier. 2.5 kilometers long, with behemoth-class offensive turrets, and capable of launching 150 Spitfires at once, half off each flight pod, with another 150 10 seconds later. She was our home base, although we didn't sleep on her. She had another 150 Excalibur 6s on board as well, in case we needed to launch bombers. But they jump-launched, not using the launch tubes like proper fighters were supposed to, and the pilots for them would come from somewhere else if they were needed. Us fighter pilots preferred not to launch that way. There were 25 Spitfire squadrons now, but some were still AI-only pilots. Wing Commander Jane still had 4 squadrons of her elite AI pilots, and another 4 squadrons were only rookie AIs. All of them had an avatar in the pilot seat. The rest of us were flesh-and-blood pilot with AI co-pilot combinations. And while my squadron were all humans, some of them were mixtures of species. I'd had no say in who I was assigned, though, and I'd have worked with anyone. The standard mission these days, which fighters got involved in, was to attack a Kira world which had a large shipyard. By the time we finished, there was to be nothing military left in the system, and no shipyards of any kind. Those, however, were magically destroyed, so no one had a shipyard on their kill score. On the way there, any Tiger fleet we saw on the nav map was on the attack list, and that was what we were tagged for. Those fleets were usually in space somewhere on their way to somewhere else and always had a combat air patrol up. It should be space, but CAP was a tradition too.
Our normal was 4 or 5 warm-up hits before the target, and we were ready to launch for the 4th one. The only difference to what I was used to was the dragon host was still stood down after some sort of rogue mage betrayal a couple of days earlier, so we were matched up with Space Marshal Serena's fleet. There was a high likelihood Hecule would end up visiting some of the other fleets as well, but to start with, we were the fighter component for her attack plan. Jason and Nikki were up as hollows on one side of my HUD. 3 smaller ones for my flight were on the other side. I'd been satisfied with the morning training sessions, but no clear squadron strafe leader had become apparent. It remained to be seen how well we did as flights now. I was still too lone wolf for my own liking, but I thought I had the flight properly behind me. Strafing was a skill. When to turn it on, when to turn it off, and what you did while you were vulnerable in straight flight as you used it determined if you survived long in the fight. The better units did, the less damage they tended to take, and the better their kill scores. I selected squadron comms with an eye blink. We're scheduled for 4th cap launch, but be prepared to go at a moment's notice if we need to launch in support of anyone else. Have your co-pilots confirm readiness to launch with Zach. They already had, but I was going to encourage the constant teamwork needed between pilot and co-pilot, and none of that was very obvious in the simulator, which was its biggest flaw. Combat was the only true crucible for forging pilot and co-pilot teamwork. That was the official line, and I believed it. I lived it. We lived it. Hecule jumped, and Wolf's squadron launched immediately. Wolf was the Space Marshal's call sign and nickname, but most of us had to be in space to use it. His squadron made short work of the Kira cap as the bigger ships engaged the Kira fleet and kept missiles off his fighters. When the Kira fighters were trashed, his squadron vanished in an eye blink back to their maintenance base. "And that," I said to the squadron, "is how you do that." They never lost squadron cohesion, and their strafing was in short, very effective bursts, which covered every angle there was an enemy fighter in. I expect us to be doing that within a couple of days. There were a few noises which indicated skepticism, but that was to be expected. Some squadrons just never managed it, but did manage to keep flights together. Others hunted better in pairs. It remained to be seen what this squadron did best, but I was aiming for the top. The fleet moved on after the last Kira destroyer had been killed. Survivors were saved magically, and hulks removed magically. But we left the remaining debris where it was to spook the locals. I usually kept an eye on what the fleet ships were doing, because the space marshals who led each fleet were fighter pilots themselves, even though they now flew behemoths, and they all had a different way of killing Kira fleets. Serena's method was basically jump in, hit selected ships with more than enough for a one-shot mission kill, then jump and do it again from a random angle. It was a safer way of engaging and used the jump drive to best effect, but it wasn't my idea of a fighter pilot's way of fighting. Then again, combat at that level was very different from what we saw. The fighters were not strictly needed, given the sheer amount of secondary guns the fleet carried, but this was also considered a form of training for us. We were here for the target, and cap suppression on the way there was just considered warming up. That's not to say it wasn't dangerous, because it was. Until the Tiger's big guns were gone, fighters remained vulnerable. But the battleships and carriers were always taken out first, and the battle wagons were our biggest threat. We waded through 2 more jumps and observed 2 of Rock Monster's squadrons in action. Then it was our turn. 3. There was no launch order. Hecule jumped in to give us the best launch position, and we were thrown straight out. There was no feeling to it, just the blur of the tube walls as you hurled forward, the shields snapping on once clear of the tube, and the speed slider being shifted by Zach to build us up to combat speed. Old-timers still talked about the kick in the guts of the catapults, but the Excalibur and Spitfire had their own internal gravity, and that no longer happened. So a few seconds of blur was all we experienced to know we'd launched. A second after we left the tubes, the carrier jumped into a better position to hit its own target, and only a few seconds behind the rest of the ships. Zach painted the lead tiger fighter, and the squadron AIs aligned us for a head-to-head approach. There were 20 of them and 12 of us. That was normal for a fleet with two carriers, which wasn't expecting to be hit, but knew they might be. Ships blinked out around us, but our focus was the fighters in front of us. I got missile-locked tone for the single missile launcher at the front and popped out four quick image recs, and then changed the target to the leader's wingman. A few seconds later, the rest of the squadron sent out a ragged volley of missiles, and I knew we needed to work on that. Missiles began firing from the Tiger fighters, but most of them exploded within seconds, as pre-fired Mosquito missiles from our fleet ships were targeted on them by ship AIs who were watching over us. Just short of what I knew was pulse range for the Tigers, I started juking the bird in a random fashion, and the rest of the squadron started to do the same. Then it was finger on the trigger time, and I fired two full salvos from the main guns and hit the strafe for long enough to line up the leader for a single salvo just as my missiles slammed home. Strafe off, and we juked past. Then it was strafe on again, a full turn to face back the way we'd come, and another single salvo into the wingman just to be sure. I had just enough remaining gunpowder in the buffer for one more salvo, and targeted one of the rear fighters which had only just gone past further over, and was surprised when it exploded from the hits. The strafe came off, and I checked for what was left. All 12 of mine were there, but we'd lost flight cohesion, which was disappointing. But given everyone had been doing their own strafing for a small engagement like this, it wasn't surprising. Also disappointing was several were not even with their wingman, and were now trying to catch up. The Tigers were history. We'd done a clean sweep on them, although one of my birds was showing some minor hull damage. I checked my shields and wasn't surprised to see them almost full. It had been that fast. Most likely, we'd hit Tigers without much combat experience.
Three kills, said Zach. Confirmed.
Not bad, Black Sheep, said the voice of Woof. RTB?
A moment later, we were hovering over our maintenance bays. The landing struts appeared, and we settled to the deck. How's your bird, Ming? I asked, in direct mode. Ming wasn't Asian, but she had the whitest skin I'd ever seen, and all I knew was she was from Karn. There was a story there, but not for now. Hers was the bird with the hull damage.
No problem, Skipper. Lost some paint where it doesn't matter.
Repair droids were checking all of our birds, which was standard after a launch. The birds didn't return to a maintenance bay if they were badly damaged, so I knew with her being there, it wasn't. In those cases, they went into storage, and the pilot was given a new bird and a jump icon to move to it. Not this time, though. I could see from the HUD display she was understating the damage, but her life support area hadn't been breached and nothing important was showing as actually damaged, so she was good to go again. By the time Hecule had jumped twice more, we were back in the tubes, but this time in the rear position. Those squadrons which hadn't launched yet now had the priority on launching next. The ship jumped again, but no one launched this time.
They're waiting for us, said the voice of Wolf.
That wasn't unusual these days.
Squadrons are getting assignments now, and most of us will be jumping after launch to get into position. Let's get this done.
The nav map showed a Kira base with a 5-fleet garrison, and they had the full complement of 700 fighters arrayed to support the big ships and stations. The extra 200 came from fighter platforms grouped around both the base and the planet, but they'd obviously had enough warning we were coming to have all their fighter forces at the base. It made us outgunned more than 2-1, but our big ships were at worse odds than that, and we expected it. Stand by, I told my squadron. Hecule jumped, and the birds in front of us shot away down the tubes. 10 seconds later, we shot out after them, and the moment we were out, Hecule vanished behind us, and we jumped ourselves. We appeared behind several squadrons of Tiger fighters, and I locked up the nearest one and fired off image recs again, then switched to guns and goosed the fighter in front of me as the missiles started to hit. They'd been slow to react, and we were still getting up to combat speed, but my target staggered from the hits and I shifted to the next nearest, juked clear of the debris the first one was turning into, and then hit the strafe. We came out the other side of those fighters with only my flight still with me, and they were a bit ragged, but we'd been effective with the strafing.
Jumping,
said Zack, and we appeared off to the side of a half squadron, and the fight continued. By my count, I'd killed another 9, some with triple-tapped torpedoes at close range, and I was lining up number 10 when something hit me unexpectedly. The bird lurched strangely, and Zack started to say we were jumping, but didn't get the whole word out. There was a flash, and then nothing. I came awake what I thought was only moments later, and was immediately aware my suit was in protection mode, both sides of the cockpit were missing, most of my chair was simply gone, the control panel in front of me seemed dead, and there was a very large solid object getting bigger ahead of me. But I still had hand controls. Zack? No answer. It was a planet, and I was going down. The HUD was dead, and there was no nav map. I had power and some maneuverability, but no thrust, so the main engine had to be dead, but the thruster engine was still functional. What I didn't have was a functioning damage report, or even a relay from the ship to my PC. Somehow, we jumped into the atmosphere of the planet, which was good, because with no shields, entry from space would have been bad for my remaining suit integrity, which was already bad since it obviously taken the brunt of a pulse, and a pretty big one. It was also bad because gravity had me, and there was only going to be one ending here. I had enough time to confirm the jump drive wasn't functional for a manual jump, but I didn't know if that was the drive being gone or damaged, or if it was just the electronics of the bird being totally fried. There was no more time anyway. The bird was going down like a rock, and so I started looking for somewhere to do a controlled crash at. Not that it looked like I was getting much of a choice. The ground below was coming at me rapidly, and it looked solid green. But as I got closer, I saw some open areas without trees, and I tried to line up on one of them as best I could. I used the forward thrusters to slow my descent by ramming the thrust lever into full reverse, and almost managed to pull off a landing, except I clipped some treetops, and we went down off the line I'd picked. At the last moment, the landing thrusters fired, but it wasn't enough, and too late, the bird slammed into the ground. Everything went black. 4. My PC told me I'd been out for nearly half an hour. I found myself lying on the ground a good deal beyond where the remains of my Spitfire was, and immediately counted myself lucky I'd not been thrown into a tree. As it was, my suit was only showing 5% integrity, and that stopped me cold as I thought about it. The new suit version merged 7 of the old suits, of which we'd previously worn 6 as loops on the belt which became hidden armbands until needed. 5% meant I'd used all 7 belt suits and had almost had it shred on me. And either it had been lower or the suit wasn't recharging properly. The pulse which hit me must have been more powerful than I thought. And then, with no seat restraints, also destroyed by the pulse, I'd been thrown clear on crashing, and the impact with the ground had almost shredded the suit. Not having done so was a bonus. I felt sore just about everywhere, but my medical monitor wasn't showing anything broken. Though a ground impact right after a pulse impact pretty much guaranteed some level of bruising. I managed to sit up without feeling too much extra pain. There was a canopy of green over the top of me, which extended to just after where the remains of my bird was. A long line of churned-up ground and some ship debris showed where we'd impacted, and then slid under cover. As far as locals finding the wreck was concerned, the evidence of a crash was obvious, so the cover was of dubious value. Standing was a bit more painful, but I managed it, hobbled over to the nearest tree, and stood there being held up by it while my head stopped being dizzy. I needed to think about locals because I was assuming I was down on the planet below where the battle had happened, and that made the locals tigers. A slip of a girl, as my father used to call me, had no chance taking on a tiger in combat, especially with a suit as depleted as mine was. Which had me checking. 6%, which was a relief. It meant the suit was starting to recharge. 5% on a single original suit was below the throwaway level, where it simply would not recharge ever again. But for the combined 7, it obviously wasn't, fortunately. Not far from me, I spotted a suitable-looking dead branch, went over, snapped off a few of the smaller branches, and tested it as a walking stick. It wasn't much good, but my head was threatening to go dizzy again, and I figured being propped up was a better idea than trying to walk unaided. A noise behind me had me reaching for my sidearm, and fortunately, finding it was still there and functional. But whatever made the noise didn't present itself for my inspection, and I reholstered the gun. Slower than I'd have liked, I hobbled back to the bird. Most of the front end was missing, so it was hard to tell what was pulse damage and what had been ripped off by the crash. But what I could see showed the top part of the front hull had taken a pulse which had vaporized it. That included the cockpit area, which on the Spitfire was behind the nose of the bird, where the entire canopy was missing, as was most of the sides and the majority of the chair. It looked like the pulse had hit the cockpit pretty well right behind me, with me being in the pulse zone but leaving the console in front intact along with the joystick and speed slider. There was not much left at all behind me. Then it looked like the front part of the nose had been ripped off in the crash. The control panel and screen were still there, and the panel still had power, and weight was showing on the screen. I wasn't sure what that meant, but for the moment, I was going nowhere anyway. I pulled the emergency pack from under what was left of the seat, and it looked intact. A quick check inside showed me everything I expected to be there was, in fact, there, including the backup sidearm, which I pulled out. A new holster appeared on my left thigh for it, and I put the gun away. Trying to hide them both brought up a message saying suit integrity was too low for that. But it was now 7%, so I merely had to wait. I'd need to check that again because I had no idea what the threshold was, and if I was found by civilians, I preferred they think I was unarmed as long as possible. I had to hope I wasn't found by troops without enough warning to try and hide. The back end of the bird showed the same pulse damage as the front, only this was more extensive and accounted for why there was no engine thrust. More than half the engine was simply gone, vaporized by the pulse. It was looking more and more like I'd taken a full turret salvo from a cruiser or battleship. And it had simply been blind luck, all bad, that I'd run into the pulses. One of them had been slightly off and missed, but the other two or three had slammed home, and whatever my shielding had been at the time hadn't been enough to stop three of them hitting, or maybe four if the other had hit the shield as well but missed the hull. Such was the luck of space combat. The bird was a write-off. I assumed Zack had done the AI bailout at the last moment, saving himself from an avatar death. So all I had to do now was jump home before anyone found me. I selected my designated medical facility icon, and my hand went to the belt button and froze. I looked down. There was no jump button on my belt. A moment's panic took hold of me, but I realized it could be anywhere now. No one had warned me a suit at 5% would lose its jump button, but I guess no one knew that. Well done me for finding a flaw in the design. Shit! And well done me for not even thinking of jumping out when I discovered I was about to crash. So I wouldn't have been able to, but it hadn't even occurred to me to try? Then again, that was never part of the training regimen, but maybe it should be. The branch gripped tighter in my hands. I looked up, expecting to see some battle evidence still happening, and maybe even some debris raining down on the planet. There was nothing. No sign of anything large in orbit, no debris leaving fiery trails behind it, and no sign of big ships. I pulled up a nav map, and there was nothing on it. Nothing at all. And there should at least have been system rocks, jump points, and some civilian stations. At that point, I lost all rational thought to panic and just stared around the sky looking for anything. and then around the seeable distance of this small clearing, and continued to not see anything but trees. When my rational mind clamped down on my emotions finally, I hobbled back to the cockpit and leaned against what was left of my life. The screen was now blank. I sat down against one of the wings, intact but with one end in the dirt, and hugged the emergency bag. 5. When I stood up again, I'd managed to get myself feeling somewhat under control again. I was also feeling less pain now and steadier. A glance into the cockpit made me feel even better. "Still with you," was on the screen. As I watched, a small bot vaguely looking like a spider crawled out of one part of the console and went into another part. It was obviously doing what repairs it could do, trying to get Zack some way of properly communicating with me. I went and looked at where the missile and torpedo launchers had been. They were gone from both ends. A short walk down the furrow, and I found the remains of the front missile launcher. I didn't want to use it in any way, but what I did want wasn't there. Our launchers these days were rift-linked to loaders on Hecule. Every fighter and bomber had a small bay where bots fed missiles or torpedoes to the launcher on the plane. It meant we no longer had to store the ordnance in the bird itself, which freed up space for more power generation, which in turn meant better shields and more trigger pulls before the gun buffer needed recharging. It also meant unlimited missiles and torpedoes during a battle. But the rift wasn't there. I went looking for the torpedo launcher, and there was no sign of it at all. And the missile launcher from the rear was just plain gone with the back end of the engine. What it meant was I had no way of communicating with home to get picked up. There was no magic sat in the system, so by some jump fluke, I wasn't on the planet below the battle and could be anywhere at all. Fleet Admiral Murdoch's first jump experience was required reading, and that showed what could go wrong with a jump. It was one reason why the bird had an emergency bag under the seat. But jumping was supposed to be instant and foolproof. I guess that made me the fool. It was still light, so no stars, and until it was dark, I'd not be able to set my PC to trying to determine where I was. With luck, I was only a short way out of the League's Magic Sat network, and they were already putting in more to try and find me. Even without luck, there was a limit on how far a fighter could jump, and that would determine a search radius. So it was only a matter of time before I was rescued. The good news, in one way, was that I wasn't on a Kira world, except that was an assumption. I could be anywhere. In some ways, though, I was lucky this planet was even habitable. And now I thought about it, it seemed the gravity was a bit heavy, and the oxygen slightly high. A part of the PC menu I'd never used before confirmed that, but neither were too much. Who did live here was another matter, if anyone at all, and what lived here was a more pressing concern. I'd not seen anything in the way of a predator yet, but the day was still young. Well, not so young as the sun was going down on the horizon now, but it was still early afternoon for me. Damn it! I'd need to adapt. A fritzing version of Zack suddenly appeared out of the cockpit. He shouldn't have been that big, but I'd have not seen him otherwise.
"Are you okay?"
he asked me, looking concerned. "Bruised, but nothing broken. You?" He laughed in a strangled sort of way.
"I've been better. I'm cut off from my primary, which under the rules means I'm now my own primary. Or will be if we're here for very long. The Spitfire is in a bad way, but it has power and sensors, albeit not connected at the moment. About half its shield emitters, and given enough time, could probably be repaired enough to fly. The worst problem would be rebuilding the engine, but it is doable if we have to."
"How much time?"
"I don't know. The repair bot is still working on things important to me, not the ship."
"How does it do repairs if it can't replace anything?"
"It can, up to a point. The Spitfire was designed with a small fabricator on board, so the repair bot could make anything it needs in this sort of situation."
Someone actually thought a crash landing on a planet might happen?
Not as such. More like being stranded in space and needing some rapid repairs before life support failed, so you could get somewhere with something you could breathe. Although that might require a planet landing. Crashing this badly wasn't part of the thinking.
But you think you could rebuild the engine enough to fly?
The bot can build other bots. Some of those bots will be gatherers to bring what we need here to feed the fabricator. Once we have the right resources, the bot can start making parts, which can then be assembled into bigger parts, and eventually build an engine. And if necessary, I can use the fabricator to make a bigger fabricator in case we need something too big for the one we have now. Those resource bots are being made now.
Comms?
Only between us. If you enable me to partly inhabit your PC, we'll be able to communicate wherever you go, at least until out of comms range. I'll appear like a hollow walking next to you, but no one else will see me.
Are you picking up other comms?
Yes, but a fair way away. That's probably a good thing. It means we're less likely to be discovered anytime soon. Sensors will tell us more.
Any sign there's ships here?
Possibly, but there's nothing in the air anywhere I can detect now. And from the nature of the comms, anything they have is not on our tech level. As I said, I'll know more when sensors are reconnected.
Make that a priority. It's next, after stabilizing what I need. A request popped up on my HUD, and I granted it. The hollow of Zack vanished, and he appeared in solid form next to me, now the same height as I was. It was a bit freaky, as I knew he wasn't really there. He was looking at the Spitfire now, and seemed to be walking around it, but only on this side, which meant he only knew what I could see in this moment.
That's better than I thought,
he said.
The hull is basically intact and just needs patching. New engine, of course. New nose, but it looks like most of the guns are either intact or repairable. The power systems just need some work, but are functioning well enough for what I need at the moment and what the fabricator needs.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.